You know, over the years, Oasis has sent lots of kids and lots of youth to Bethel Camp. We're always going there. It's good to have Bethel Camp come here. So this is just a little conversation which we can get better acquainted with each other. Joelle, starting with you, could you tell us a little bit about your background? And because your family line goes back to Eastern Kentucky, not real far from Bethel Camp. Can you tell us how that happened?
So my grandparents moved from Delaware down to Eastern Kentucky with the Mennonite group of missionaries that went down there.
Yes.
I don't know how they actually got acquainted with Bethel Camp, but I'm sure there's not a ton of people who came down with the Mennonite group to Eastern Kentucky. So
right.
Probably all knew each other. So I know that they worked at camp, like my grandparents did.
They worked at the camp? Yeah. Your grandparents did?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not like full-time, but they would volunteer and like do summer stuff. And then my mom went, and then we went all went when we were kids. So it was fun. We moved from Eastern Kentucky when I was two. So I didn't grow up in Eastern Kentucky.
I see.
But because my grandparents were there, like we'd come spend summers and go to camp every year.
So this was way back in the 50s. It was one of the first mission outreaches of Rosedale Network of Churches, of which this congregation is a part of. And if we could show this slide here of a little church. That is, you probably recognize that. It's right on the edge of the campus of Bethel Camp. They're probably having a service there right now. And do you worship there, or?
We personally do not.
Okay.
Nothing against the church at all.
Yeah.
There.
Okay. Is your mic on?
Maybe. Am I on? Yes. You hear me? Yes. They said so.
Okay.
I'm good.
All right. Good. All right. Sorry.
But we just wanted some reason to leave campus, at least guaranteed. So we live actually on property right along the driveway, and then we work there, or I work there. So some excuse to get out into civilization on Sundays is a good thing.
Sometimes it can be restful to get away from the place where you're doing a lot of work.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, so you may be interested in knowing that my wife, Audrey, her family was part of that mission endeavor as well before she was born. She was born, if we could show the next picture, not in a hospital, but she was born in her home under what was called the Frontier Nursing Service. And they would go back into the hills with these horses to deliver babies. And I don't know if anybody noticed or not, but if you head out Rochelle's Road going towards the airport, you know what I'm going to say. There is a Frontier Nursing University there. That's what my wife was born under. And so I don't know, Audrey, were there horses there that day when you were born? You don't remember? Okay.
So I've got a question for Audrey. Was it the house that we're living in that you were born in?
No, I was actually born on Gate Street.
Okay.
In the area, but then they built a dam there, and so her family had to move. And that's when they did move into the very house where you guys are living right now on Bethel Camp.
No, Ezra was not born with the horse brigade.
He was
born at camp.
Really?
Yes. So
intentionally.
Wow. Intentionally. Yes.
It was intentional.
It was on purpose.
Like midwife there?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
No horses though.
Yeah. Well, one of the things I read about the Frontier Nursing Service is that their infant mortality rate was actually lower than the national average. So I think they did a really good job. So, Joelle, how did you come to meet this man?
We went to Campbellsville University together.
So
we were in the same like Bible study group. So we kind of knew of each other, we got to each other eventually.
You knew of each other before you went to Campbellsville?
No, not before. At Campbellsville.
We
kind of knew of each other in a group.
I see.
We ended up being next to each other in a church potluck line, and everybody else around was talking, so we ended up having to talk.
Okay, so Roger and Ruthie both have been camp directors for many years, and now you all are the camp director. How long have you been the camp director, and can you tell us something that you like about being the director,
so
Cody?
So we moved down in May of 2022. We moved in for a week, then we did camp, And then, as you all know, or likely know, we did flood recovery cleanup stuff that fall with the 22 flood that impacted the area. And for me, sometimes people think it's like, ah, well, Roger came in, replaced Eldon. You're here to replace Roger. But it's actually something more that Roger gets to do more behind-the-scenes work. So on paper, he is the executive director, and I'm the program director, which in camp ministry means that you do everything.
So the campers would see your face more than they would see Roger's
yes.
face.
So I direct 6 weeks of the summer, and Roger directs the other three. So I say I direct the quote-unquote average week of camp, so junior one, junior two, and high school. And Roger has family camp, day camp, and then we have a special needs week as well.
A special needs, okay. That's a little bit about the programming. Mm-hmm. Anything else that you would want to say about the programming?
People sometimes think that, oh, well, camp's the busy time, June or July, which it is. It's like, oh, so it's the off season, you don't do anything. Far from. We always have something going on. I know Donna's going to share in a little bit about some things that we have going on that aren't directly at camp. Okay. But then, of course, prepping for board meetings and fall retreats. And we yeah. actually had one of the people, Trey, you want to wave at us? He was luckily at camp with us. We got to install some leach lines, replace our leach field. It's 1,000 feet of wow. of leach line. Was not wow. exciting, but it had yeah. to be done.
right.
So yeah. we do yeah. it all.
Oh, I can believe that you are very busy all oh, yes. the time. Just, I mean, there's actually doing the programming and the ministry, and then there's also preparation mm-hmm. for it. And sometimes the preparation is more time consuming than the
yes,
program can be. Does anybody have, we have a microphone here. Does anyone have any questions that you would like to ask about Bethel Camp? Or maybe they answered all of your questions.
How many kids go to camp every summer?
We had 519 this summer. So that's all spread out across the 9 weeks. So your average week of camp looks around 65, 70 kids. And then we, at current capacity, that's everybody in a normal bunk bed in all 10 cabins, is 80 kids and 20 staff. But of course, sometimes high school is like, oh, well, I have a hammock, I can sleep on the floor, we can put 14 in here. It's like, okay. And so we can stretch that, and I think the biggest number of kids that we've had is 99. So we've not actually met the 100 mark yet. We're hoping to add on an additional cabin. So it would give us 5 boys' cabins, 5 girls' cabins. If you all have been there, the girls' hillside, the long trek up to the upper cabins. So they would keep those. And then we have a handicap accessible cabin there. Again, if you're familiar with camp, it's between the dining hall and Sunbeam, kind of tucked over in a corner with a little ramp, so it's accessible that way. So,
how many of you all have been to Bethel Camp for any reason whatsoever? Raise your hand. That's quite a few. Yeah. Do you know, are there a lot of kids that come from this, like the Lexington area? I mean, I know our kids mm-hmm. do. But
we've got a pretty good mix.
Richmond, Lexington.
So Richmond, Lexington, that's the majority of the Kentucky part, right?
Yeah. That aren't local.
That aren't
like,
that
local.
Yeah.
Kids.
There's quite a
we
few local
Lexington
kids.
We have Lexington and Richmond, yeah. and so then we have out of state.
Yeah. So yeah. as the age group gets older, so of course day camp, they get dropped off and picked up. It'd be a little bit of a far drive for you all.
Yeah.
So it's very local ministry to the younger, but as the kids get older, we have more and more from either this area or Ohio or North or South Carolina, and then a couple from here and there, yeah. just sporadically.
Yeah. I don't know if you do a lot of statistics or not, but has anybody ever broken it down in terms of denominational affiliation? I'll bet the answer is no, but I don't know.
So I am a nerd. So I have two,
wow.
I have, my background is two.
We have some hope.
Oh yes.
Yeah, nerds bring hope.
So I have 2 math degrees. Numbers are my thing.
And what are your degrees?
I have a degree in math education for middle and high school. And then an additional master's in mathematics education. And then a couple hours in Christian apologetics.
Wow.
So, yeah. love nerding out. But
when you were studying math, were you thinking about camp, being a camp director?
Not at all. No. Nope. Not in the slightest. But I use my degree of education degree more in both the planning and the dealing with kids and the staff more than I ever thought. And I've got a couple back there, a couple of staff members.
Which is hardest, the kids or the staff?
Depends on the day.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Right.
So. You just never know what you're going to get into.
Yeah. So anyway, denominational.
Yeah. So I would say, somewhere between a third and half maybe come from a background of Mennonite church. Okay. It's interesting, and I'm sure that you all understand this too. So if we're at a camp conference or something, we're with Bethel Mennonite Camp, it's like, oh my gosh, like, where do they park their horses and like where are their buggies?
It's because it's associated with the Mennonite.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So
And Mennonite and Amish have the same historical roots. Yeah.
Yes. So everyone thinks like, oh my gosh, like I can't.
Yeah, it's like this church we used to meet out at the Sheraton back then, and I walked up to the desk one time and asked a question, and he wanted to know who I was. Mennonite said, "Oh, you're the guys with the ox carts." Yeah.
Not quite. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah.
So it is interesting. Trying to explain to people, like, no, we actually, you couldn't pick us out amongst a crowd. We have all sorts. And it's interesting that most of our kids have some affiliation with a church. So some camps are maybe more evangelical, but I think our model is much more discipleship based. A lot of our staff, I would say maybe even above 90% of our staff are past campers. So.
Wow. Yes.
It's really, really special.
So when the campers come, they're really in training for...
Yes. I tell my staff all the time that what...
Like they both went to...
Both campers. Yeah. And I tell them that whatever they are doing now sets the precedent for the things that I have to fix in the future. Because so they're...
Take it easy on them.
Yes,
man.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. Donna Walker is here. Can you come on up, Donna? Donna serves on the board there, and we can just remain seated here. And if you don't mind giving that mic to Donna, Donna, you could just go over here to the pulpit and share what you have to share at this time.
So, Jim asked me if I would just kind of tell a little bit about the board. The board is representative of the 8 Eastern Kentucky Mennonite churches. So there is a member from 8 of the Eastern Kentucky Mennonite churches there. I'm from Oasis. And then we have 3 members at large, and then of course our 2 camp directors. So that's who makes up the board with it. And we meet twice a year, and we help vision and help undergird the directors and the campers, and that's the main thing that we're trying to do.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, and then you're going to share your meditation
this
time.
Okay, I just want, when I think about Bethel Camp and I think about our kids that went and the experiences they had there, many of the campers described their week at Bethel Camp as a mountaintop experience. This often happens, y'all, with all of us while we're worshiping with fellow believers or when we've had undistracted time alone in God's Word. The exhilaration of being with Jesus is just hard to put into words. But it's these defining moments that sustain and encourage us when we have to go back down that mountain and live out our everyday lives. We even see this in Scripture at the Transfiguration. Peter, James, and John got to share an actual mountaintop experience with the Lord when they witnessed a preview of the unveiled glory of Christ. They actually saw a blazing light and heard a booming voice from heaven. God brought the glory of the transfiguration of his son into the little faith and limited understanding of these 3 disciples. Sounds like a lot of us when we're at camp, of little faith and limited understanding. Despite the wonder of the moment, Peter, James, and John could not stay on that mountain, nor can campers stay at Bethel Camp. They, like the disciples, have to descend that mountain into everyday life. But they don't leave alone. They leave with Jesus, who continues to reveal his glory through his presence and his word, teaching, growing, and sustaining each camper on their earthly journey. So let's take a look right now at this video to see what contributes and facilitates that Bethel Camp mountaintop experience. Maybe. The fun and the activities you just saw, I mean, in those mountains, those kids are unplugged totally in the beauty of God's creation. And I love it. There are kids from out of state, people in state, and everyone just gets to experience the community of God. And it's often a unique experience for many children at the beginning when they do this. But it's the encounters with the Lord, and you saw those kids in their Bibles, doing Bible, trying to find scripture. It's the encounters with the Lord, these mountaintop conversations with campers, staff, directors that sustain these campers for a lifetime. They often meet the Lord for the first time there. At the Transfiguration, the very voice of Almighty God interrupted Peter's conversation and said, "This is my son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." To listen suggests hearing with anticipation and a readiness to respond. God's word, "Listen to him," reverberates through the years to us today and to our campers at Bethel Camp. Camp is a setting that facilitates listening. You can see that to Jesus's parables and teaching, and to his revelation of the kingdom of God, to his commission, and to when God directs us to take heart and to fear not. Peter, James, and John fell on their faces in speechless wonder and humility in response to what they witnessed upon hearing God's voice. What did Jesus do next? He gently touched them. Yes, at the end of their incredible mountaintop experience, the disciples looked up. There stood Jesus. He was right there with them, full of reassurance. Those disciples would never look at Jesus in the same way again. Likewise, our prayer is that our campers, after a week at Bethel Camp, after they leave going down the mountain with Jesus in their lives, full of gentle reassurance and purpose to enjoy him and glorify him forever, never look at him the same way. May their faces and their lives reflect that mountaintop experience with God's glory to a world that's hungry to know him. And I know this past year, with over those 500 kids have been impacted for an eternally, with eternal gifts that will go with them their entire lives. So we invite you all, this ministry is not just up there, we're all part of that. And we invite you to come and have your own mountaintop experience with God in whatever way he places on your heart. Come as a camper, see lots of little ones that are getting of age, as a camp counselor, as a sponsor of a camper, as a prayer warrior, as a financial supporter, as a cook, as a volunteer staff, as a volunteer work crew, or a volunteer maintenance person. Just go to bethelcamp.org. It is the easiest website. Bethel Camp, we're not a company, it's .org. Easy. Just go to that website and you can donate there. We also have cards and envelopes in the back if you want to help with that. And you can check off how you'd like to serve and if you would like to financially support. So come to Bethel Camp in whatever way God calls you to have a mountaintop experience, a defining moment with God that will sustain and encourage you when you leave. It's not just the campers.